Là, ça va aller. Comment as-tu réussi? Il se fait bien. Il se fait bien. Trois léa. 지구
Begin with, I would like to begin by offering my greetings to all the Lamas, Chulpas, and spiritual friends, Geshes, who have gathered for the 24th Kagyu Gunshir, the members of the Sangha. So I'd like to wish you all my warm greetings. And so the original plan for this Kagyu Gunshir, because we weren't able to have the Marangok summer teachings last year, I thought that I should continue with that topic. But because of some things I had to do, I was unable to, I did not have time, and so I could not continue with those teachings. However, all the teachers and kempos from the Shudras asked me to, they told me that I absolutely must, that you absolutely must teach some Dharma during this teaching. And so in the past, he had taught the 100 short instructions of the 8th Karmapa Dorje, and so if you could continue that, there is some left, that would be good. And so for that reason, for 4 days, I will continue with the remaining, some of the remaining teachings from Mikyo Dorje's 100 short instructions. Now, the point where we've got to in the 100 short instructions is that we finished the essential meanings on the three essential points, and we have come to the instruction on Gaoyang Gumba's seven pointing outs. This is the point we are at. Now, to sort of elaborate a little bit here, when you talk about transmissions or lungs, there are reading transmissions, there are explanatory traditions, and there are instructional transmissions, and so forth. There are many different types. Now, when we talk about a reading transmission, what do we mean by that? Well, in the Vinaya, we talk about giving transmissions in the Vinaya texts, and I think this is what it means. Now, what is meant in the Vinaya by giving transmission of a scripture? Is that originally the scriptures of Buddhism were not written down. And originally the scriptures were not written down in words, on letters. So the Buddha would say something orally and the students would memorize what he said. So especially the students who have achieved the Dharani power of perfect memory. And then they would recite them to each other from memory. They'd one would recite to the next, then they'd recite to the next, and so they translate. And so they teach them orally. This is the tradition at the time. And so at that time, the students would teach new students or new monastics by reciting the texts, the scriptures that they'd memorized to those new students or those new monastics. And they'd teach them, and then also the students had to memorize them. And so in order for the students to rememorize them, you had to recite it a minimum of three times. Yes, this is the minimum number of times. There's a limited time of three times that is taught. I think those of sharp faculties probably were able to memorize it after only 3 times. But the people of lesser faculties, who weren't quite so clever, needed to be read many times until they had memorized. So in brief, the transmission was had to be recited as many times as it took for the student to recite. And this is what was called as giving the transmission of the scripture. And so then when it was memorized and the student had was well trained, it was called that they had received the transmission. That's what's called when it had been memorized. Then once they had memorized it, they had to recite it over and over again so as not to forget it. This is what was called reciting it. And so it's basically this reciting means repeating the text that they had already memorized. And so the reason why giving transmissions began is, as I mentioned before, is that originally when the teachings first spread, the teachings were not written, and so they were had to be taught orally by repeating the texts. And they had to be repeated over and over again until the student had memorized the texts. And the students would repeat after the guru, and doing over this is what is meant by giving a scripture, a transmission at the time. But in Tibetan, all the scriptures were written down. So there is no need to go to such lengths. But it seems like there's a little bit of that tradition, a remnant of that tradition, previous tradition remaining in terms of giving a tradition. So they're giving a reading transition is probably a remnant of that transmission, of that earlier tradition. From the time when the scriptures that were not written down on paper. So I think that's a remainder of that, from that time. When we talk about an explanatory transmission, that means reciting all the words of the scripture clearly three times and occasionally giving a little bit of explanation or commentary. And so there are some who say that this is what is meant by an explanatory transition. When we talk about an instruction transition is when a guru themselves and gives an explanation according to the experience that they've developed in their being. And so this is called an instruction transmission. So in brief, for a transmission, the main thing is knowing the words, or in structures, knowing the meaning is primary. If the student has understood, then no matter how many times the teacher has explained it, other than merely irritating the student's ears, making their ears hurt, then there's no way that they could have possibly received a transmission. So in this way, there's a little instruction, a little bit of a difference between a transmission and an instructions. But when we talk about separate transmissions and instructions, making a different presentation of transition instructions is not written down clearly in any sutra or tantra. But as the when we look at the sutras, the tantras, or the texts by the Indian masters, there's nothing clear about transmissions or instructions in those texts. But as the students' minds declined, or as their power diminished, then there came a point where it was necessary to give the transmission and the instruction separately. During the time of the Buddha, there was no differentiation of saying this is an instruction, this is a transmission. But because the strength of the student's minds has gradually declined over time, then there became to be a clear distinction between a transmission and instruction. And I think if we don't understand them, then I think it's because if they weren't given instructions, the students wouldn't have the ability to understand it clearly. And so I think that this distinction between the instructions and reading instructions is a little bit different as the matters of the past. So what I'm giving today is like an explanatory tradition. So primarily I'm going to be reading the text by Mikyo Dorje, the instructions on the seven points of the seven pointing outs by Yang Gompa. I'll read that, and occasionally I will give, if I have some opinions or some thoughts, then I will say a few. But to begin with, before I speak about these instructions on the seven pointing outs, I would like to, what Mikkyu Dorje wrote is a commentary on the instructions of the seven points out, and there is the root text. The root text was written by Gyawa Yang Gunpa. So I thought I would give a brief introduction to Gyawa Yang Gunpa. So who was Gyawa Yang Gunpa? Within the Dapo Kagyu, there is the Drupa Kagyu. And so this is one of the lineages that's passed on from Dharma Pama Drupa. And among these great students was the lineage of the Pama Drupa Kagyu spread widely in Tibet. And in particular, there was the Drupa. So at one time in Tibet, the Drupa Kagyu teachings spread very widely in the beacon. There are many who had great interest in the Drupa Kagyu teachings. And because of this, so this Drupa Kagyu lineage, the founder of this tradition was Drogon Sampa Gyare. Now, Drogon Sampa Gyare had the early great Pakyang, in the middle of the great ones were Gyaren, and then the final great ones Lodepa and Gudzampa. So these were the two later great students that are very well known. And so among them, one was the Gudzang Gompa Dorje. And he had several students. Among them, he had Yang Gumpa, who was equal to him in realization. Orjimpa was equal to him in austerity. Chilakar was equal in his resolve. And Rinpa was equal in devotion. So we're speaking about Yang Gumpa, who was equal to him in realization. So Yang Gumpa was known all over Tibet as both a scholar and meditation master. He was very well known, very famous. Now, the place that Gyawa Yang Gunpa was born was in the southern part of Latur, in a place called Fadong, where there's a monastery there, it seems. And he was in a family line of unbroken family line of Nyingma Siddhis. So they're from the Nyingma lineage, and they were all Ngakpas. His father's name was Josam, and his mother was named Chutong. And he was born as their son in 1213. Now, even while he was in the womb, his mother had many extraordinary visions or signs in her dreams. In particular, she also naturally developed samadhi without needing to meditate on it. So she was able to develop samadhi naturally. Not long after Yang Gunpa was born, he was able to speak, and he said, "I go for refuge." Also, when he was young, when he was learning to read and write, when he was reading to stuff, he didn't need to be taught them. He just naturally, knew them. Probably around the time before he was born, his father had probably already passed away. So the person who, primary person who remained and who raised him was his mother. So when he was, even when he was very little, he would tell people, he would encourage people to practice the Dharma. And this is from when he was very, very little. From the time he was old, at 5 years old, he began singing songs that really helped other people. The songs that he sang with his wife are really very, both their words and their meaning are extremely profound. And these are all within the collected songs of Young Gumpa. And there are many songs that he started singing from the age of five. So he's different from any other child. And he did many amazing things. And so for this reason, everyone would said, oh, there's a Nirmanakaya. And that's how that he came famous as this. When I say Choku, this would mean like a Choku who's been recognized, but not like a Choku at that time. But at that time, when they say Choku, they meant someone who is different from any other child, who from a very young age was really amazing child. And so all the public, everyone around would say, oh, he's a Nirmanakaya. He's not just an ordinary kid. And so he became very well known for that. Now, when he reached the age of six, he met a guru named Pulmarwa, and he received the Maya empowerment of and the Dzogchen instructions in the Tantra of great perfection, as well as instructions from the Kadampa, the Shiche, the true lineage, and the essential topics of the path and its result. And so he received all these teachings at a very young age, the age of six. When he reached the age of nine, he began to give teachings to people, and he was able to instruct other people. If we're an ordinary person at the age of nine, forget about giving instructions to anyone else. First of all, you don't even know what you're doing. But he was different from anyone else. And so for the time that he was able to care for many students and give them instructions. And at the age of 22, he took full ordination from a Kempo Watson Sokhawa, the master of the ritual was called Drakpa, and the private question was Jochung, and there was also a Sangha of 80 students. He was given the name Gyatsen Bal. Later, he founded a monastery at Shirin Namding. And he spent 1 year sitting there in Vajra posture. That probably means that unless he had to go to the bathroom, he'd sat continually in the Vajra posture doing meditation. So basically, he spent all his time in isolation and solitude and giving instructions to his students. And anyway, from that time, he became very well known. And people from all areas of Tibet, in particular people from central Tibet, came to him and said that he had actually over 10,000 students. And because of his students asking him, he wrote the Three Cycles of Mountain Dharma, which are one of his, he wrote many different other Dharma texts that have really particular features of Yang Gumpa's. For myself, when I have read many old instructions by Gyawa Yang Gumpa, they're different than anyone else's. They're really special treatings, and I've read that. In the end, when he was 46, in the year 1258, he passed away. So he had many students, but among them, the two primary students was one who had met him at the time that he was 5 years old, and one of the people who said he was a Nirmanakaya. And so someone had heard that he was a Nirmanakaya and went to meet him, and went to see him. And so there was one student who started studying with him from the age of five, and his name was Chenga Rujin Den. So he was one of his primary students. And the other of his students was Lore Chichong Pa. So those two were his primary students. In particular, there was Chenga Rujin Den's student, Surpukpa, and he had a student in Barawa. And Barawa was So that the upper and the lower and the middle Drupa Kagyu, so that was certain. So the upper Drupa Kagyu lineage was primarily spread by Rawa. And so this way, this is the activities of Gyao Yang Dunpa was were very broad and vast. So that's an introduction to Gyao Yang Dunpa. And so next, what we are speaking about is the seven pointing outs. When you say about the seven pointing outs, how did the seven pointing outs text come about? Well, the author is Gyao Yang Dunpa, the one who wrote the root text. So we're talking about the instructions on Yang Dunpa's seven pointings that's on the 100 short instructions of Mikyo Dorje. So this is like a commentary on this root text. So these are so it has a root text, and the root text was written by Gyao Yang Dunpa. So how is it that Yang Dunpa wrote it? So there's the year that he wrote that he founded the monastery in Hla Ding, and there were 25 students who came to receive new students who came to receive instructions from him. They'd never received any instructions before. So there are these 25 new students, and then we gave instructions to them. Before he even taught them, there were five who achieved developed realization before he taught about the main instructions. Just when he taught the preliminary instructions, they developed realization. So the five of the 25 developed realization on just hearing the preliminary instructions. And there wasn't even one of them who didn't develop meditation. So basically, all of the students who received the instructions were able to develop meditation. They were able to develop shamatha and so forth in their beings. And so Yang Gumbhut was absolutely delighted, and he sang the song. He sang the song of the seven pointing outs. Now this song, the seven points of seven point outs, has an homage at the beginning and advice to others as a conclusion. But they're not included in Mikyo Dorje's commentary in the text. But they are in the collected songs of Yang Gumpa. And they're also in a commentary by Bharawa Gyatsen Pelsang on this text, the seven pointings out. And this text by Bharawa Gyatsen Pelsang is called The Torch of the Precious Instructions. So the beginning, these two parts, the homage at the beginning and the advice to others as a conclusion. So there are a couple of extra stanzas there. Since they're not Mikyo Dorje's song, I will fill them in according to how they're in the Gyao Yang Gumpa's collected text, and then according to Bharawa's commentary. So I thought that to divide the text into different sections, it'd be good to take Bharawa's Torch of the Precious Instructions as the basis. And so in general, when we talk about the reason why it's called the Seven Pointing Outs, this is mentioned about before, but basically the reason why we call it seven instructions. First, the instructions of shamatha. Second is instructions on insight. Third is instructions on freedom from elaborations. Fourth is instructions on the natural liberation of movement. Fifth is instructions on one taste. Sixth is instructions in continuous meditation. And the seventh is the instructions on devoting oneself to practice. So these are the seven sections. And so these will be mentioned during this section on the main topic. So there are three main topics, or three main parts to the seven pointing outs, according to Bharawa's commentary. There are three main topics. And the first is an homage, pointing out the purpose and thus determining the nature. There is the long explanation of meaning and that presents the paths and levels, and the concluding advice for others, advice for others. So these are the three main sections. So as I mentioned in Mikyo Dorje's commentary, the homage and the determination of the nature and the final concluding advice to others are not included in Mikyo Dorje's text. So these two parts are not included in that. He begins directly from the longer explanation of the text. Now, the root text was found in Yikyao Yangunpo's collected songs, and so I'd like to, so there's the text is found there, and there's also the commentary by Barawa. And so these both include the entire root text, and so I'm going to fill it in with these two. And so the first, there's the homage and the request for blessings has two parts. It has an actual homage and a request for blessings. And the actual text says, Namo Ratnaguru, Lord incomparable precious guru, who enjoys the pleasures of samsara and nirvana through the naturally clear awareness with no object and has gained mastery over appearing empty phenomena, I prostrate at the feet of your Sambhogakaya. When you say Namo Ratnaguru, from the line Namo Ratnaguru to I prostrate at the feet of your Sambhogakaya, this is the homage. And then there's the line, bless me with deep, clear experience. This is the request for blessings. And so this is basically the meaning of the homage. So I don't need to explain this too much. Of course, there are very profound things that one could say, but I'm not sure that I can say them. And so I think I shall not explain. So next, if we look at the 100 instructions, it says instructions on Yao Yampa's 7 points at putting up. I prostrate at the feet of the Lord of Yoga, Nyingpo Drupa, and go for refuge. Please grant your blessings. There is no actual accomplishment of the Mahamudra of the Kagyu lineage passed down from the Dharmakaya Vajradhara to the precious guru, great Naropa, unless the analogous and true wisdom of the three supreme and higher paramas has become manifest. But these days, there are also the ways of teaching shamatha and insight that are common to the causal vehicles of Prajnaparamita. Instructions passed down from the protector of teaching as lamp of path of enlightenment to the great spiritual friend Dandrupa and Geshe Gompala, known as the co-merchant union. Lord Gompala and Madhupa gave these the name co-merchant union of Mahamudra for the sake of degenerate beings to delight in the highest vehicle. As the text says, appearance and emptiness are primordially convergent. Since the instructions join them as one, they're known as the co-merchant union. Based on these words, Lamsays these days point out the very mere appearance, mere clarity, mere awareness. And people decide that shamatha, insight, and the three kayas are all naturally complete, inherent in them. They can be nowhere else. In that, their minds mislead them about the implicit and ulterior meanings of the words of the Kagyu gurus. Particularly here in Utsang, there is a great sectarian instance in Lord Drukpa then, and the words of that the words of Gutsampa, Yangumpa, and others are used are the words sources for people's own mistaken fabrications. I cannot bear seeing this, so I shall give a textual explanation of the Lord of Dharma, Yangumpa's 7 pointing outs. So please offer the tea and drink the tea as you listen. The Dharma Expense Palace of Akanishta is the essence of all Buddhas. The three times, it shows me directly my mind and stomach. I offer to my glorious fruit guru.
Is that going to 미규도 지기 야양괴 병어주 주미 티기 다 링롱 왔어
Now, the introduction to Mikyo Dorje's instructions on Nyangumpa's seven pointing outs includes a law. He speaks a lot about a lot of different situations. There are many different things we need to understand here. And he's speaking about the actual accomplishment of Mahamudra. And he says, speaking about the that if you can only receive this actual accomplishment, if you have the realized the analogous natural true wisdom of the three supreme higher wizards, then he speaks about how there's the teachings on shamatha and instructions from Madhisha that have then passed down through the Gampopa and given the name of the co-emergent union of Mahamudra. So here, these instructions on the seven points of the instructions of seven points, so giving instructions on the paths and levels of Mahamudra about the four yogas with the three parts each for 12 stages. There's a text by Dikpa Lama that is very similar to Nyangumpa's, which is pointing out the realization of the paths and levels of Mahamudra. The paths and levels of Mahamudra have many different names. We talk about the four yogas with three stages each, and so there are many different terms for them. One point is simplicity, the one flavor and non-meditation, and these simplicity, one taste, and there are many different divisions in each of these three. And so this is the way we talk about the progression of the paths and levels of Mahamudra. It's the way we describe the paths and levels of Mahamudra, the different ways that the Mahamudra instructions are talked about. It's important that we know them. And you see, the Dalai Lama once said to me, what are these one-pointed, one simplicity, one taste, and non-meditation that we caught you cogitate? Talk about it. What are they? And at that point, I knew only a little bit about the terms of these four, but I didn't really know how you could really identify each of these. And so at that time, I was really unable to give him an answer directly. So when we talk about one-pointedness, simplicity, one taste, and non-meditation, so what are these? So what is the presentation of this is something that we need to consider, something that we need to keep in mind. And so Yawayangpa has an instruction on the four yogas and the three parts each, and and even Lord Tsongkhapa really thought very highly of that. Lord Tsongkhapa took a great interest in the presentation of the paths and levels according to Nyangumpa. I'll speak about that in the next coming days. I don't need to say it tomorrow because there are a lot of many different presentations of these four different yogas and the three stages at each. And so was Gyal Nyangumpa's presentation that Lord Tsongkhapa liked most. In any case, when you think about the four yogas and the three stages each, so when we talk about these four yogas and the presentation of the four yogas, there are many people who speak about it and who actually make objections to them, even within the Kagyu lineage itself. But there's an instruction from the tradition of Vaitisha that's passed on to Gampopa that uses this term, the four yogas and the three stages each. And so when we're thinking about what the instructions called the co-union of Mahamudra, probably these instructions on Mahamudra passed on from Vaitisha to Gampopa. So let us speak about that more later. In any case, there are these the instructions on the core emergent in Mahamudra, this passed from Atishta Kumbhava, and that later was passed down to Lord Gampopa and the Venerable Padmadrupa. And so there are many, at that time, there are many students who are a little bit degenerate, but who had great delight in the highest vehicle. And so they called for them, they called the name, these instructions, the core emergent of Mahamudra. So sometimes we talk about the Sutra tradition Mahamudra and the Ta tradition Mahamudra, and then the essence Mahamudra. We talk about these three different types of Mahamudra. And these are taught in terms of different ways of teaching the pith instructions of Mahamudra. So that's the way we divide it into the Sutra tradition and the Tantra tradition. But in any case, some people say that there's no difference between Sutra and Tantra and Mahamudra. So there are people who say that, but Mithya Dorje says in the beginning, the chariot of practice cities, that speaks about the Sutra tradition, Sutra Mahamudra and the Tantra Mahamudra. And he said that the Sutra Mahamudra is the Mahamudra that you need to do, that you don't need any empowerments to practice. This is what we call the path of liberation of Mahamudra. So following the thought of the sutras of the King of Samadhis and then developing Mahamudra through that. So that is what they called the Sutra Mahamudra. So this is basically what they're speaking about at this point. So next, it's in the beginning of the seven, we've come to the beginning of the actual text on the seven pointing outs. So we've come to the main part of the text. So as I said before, there are seven different parts to this, like the seven parts of the seven part topics of it. And among the seven topics, the first of them is instructions on shamatha. So it's the instructions on shamatha. There's instructions on shamatha, if we divide into the topics, as three. It's how to rest the mind, how to resting evenly without fabrication, and then taking thoughts as the path. This is according to Bharawa Gyaltsen Pazang. So he talked about it in three sections. So the first is the method for resting the mind. So this picture is an old printed edition of Yangonpa's collected works. The older one, that is the old pictures, the facsimile of the old text, and then the one below is the one found in Mikyo Dorje's instructions, and they're a little bit different. So the one below is the one found in Mikyo Dorje's 100 short instructions. The one above is the one found in Gyao Yangonpa's collected works. We speak about it from the instruction says, fortunate children who long to meditate, don't look outside for meditation, look inside. It won't happen by placing it, let it go. You won't catch it by grasping, rest relaxed. This is teaching the method for resting the mind. I continue reading it. The next is to that point is resting the mind. The next is resting evenly without fabrication. This is the middle part. And what this says is, if you wish to meditate, there are appearances of non-meditation. Look at them. Do not cut meditation into chunks, rest evenly. The nature has always been meditation. Don't alter it with your mind. Let it be, do not distort it with fabrication. Deep-rooted, clear meditation cannot be changed by experience. So this is the resting evenly without fabrication. So now if I read a little bit from the 100 short instructions, the meaning of that is, instead of looking outside for meditation, such as the eye consciousness functioning on conceptually and blankly towards forms, the sixth mental consciousness must look inside one pointedly at a virtuous focus. The sixth mental consciousness is momentary by essence, So if you place it for one instant, the instant being impermanent can only perish. So samadhi will not be continuous, so let it go. The moment of samadhi transcends the apprehended object, but samadhi will not apprehend the next instant. So during the moment of samadhi itself, relax, undisturbed by any predication incompatible with samadhi. If you want to meditate with a mind withdrawing inside, there are no appearances that cannot be meditated on, because the five sense consciousnesses and their objects must be gathered inside. When samadhi becomes a single stream, do not cut it into chunks with distraction. When the nature of meditating on samadhi initially arises in your mind state, your stream, you should rest without altering it, without any other thoughts. According to some, has always been meditation means that this very mind has been samadhi by essence, but that is not so. If it were, samadhi would not depend upon accumulation and purification. When samadhi is pure, naturally, and let be, and not distorted or fabricated effort, samadhi is rooted deeply and clear. When pointed on the focus, it cannot be changed by the circumstances of pleasure-seeking and malice. In general, the shamatha or dhyana that acts as the Buddhist path may be a worldly or supramundane one-pointed mind preceded by the listening to and contemplation of the bodhisattva scriptures. It is resting in a virtuous mind that is either shamatha, insight, or both. To classify it, it can be worldly or supramundane. There are three types: that which is resting in bliss in this life, that which accomplishes the qualities of samadhi, and that which benefits beings. The first produces a pliancy of body and mind of all thoughts. It is free of conceit, experience of the flavor, and predications of simony. Then second accomplishes the qualities, including countless qualities, samadhis, including the 10 families, the names, the shravakas, and others, should not even know, as well as the liberations, overpowering sense bases, and unhindered knowledge as of a bodhisattva. The third is the perfect activity for the sake of sentient beings on the basis of jhana. Regarding to how to accomplish such samadhi, to continue with the expansions, according to the topics by Bharava, it's called taking thoughts as the path. But what it reads is, without viewing conceptual mind as a thought or specifically meditating on non-thought, let mind be as it is and post to look at, your meditation will reach the pith of shamatha. These days, even when meditating on the profound completion stage of the secret mantra, the focus is our conceptual meditation, but Mahamudra that is beyond mind cannot be conceived in conceptual meditation, so people say that conceptual meditation is pointless. Some say that such thought itself is Mahamudra, but in either case, like beating a thief with a stick, they are merely saying it. They have nothing to say, to respond. In general, shamatha is holding the mind on the 11 thoughts of virtuous mindful factors, such as faith. Also, when one accomplishes the shamatha of a one-pointed mind in the yoga of the illusory creation phase, that conceptualization of visualizing the coarse aggregates and forms of the harika is a cognition of what is not something as being it, a thought that looks outward and fixates on it as a resplendent deity. But in order to accomplish through self-awareness the thought-free mind that looks inward, the forms are mixed with the nature, the cause, for the pure harika to appear. So the conservation of the creation phase brings the highest level of coherence for thought-free cognition. Thus, the result of clear appearance of self-awareness and thought-free perception is awakened to Buddhahood in the form care of the Kaya. As long as there are thoughts predicated in form, there are thoughts that fixate on the resplendent deity that dispel such confusion. But when, from the perspective of one for whom thought-free wisdom arises, the harika, there are no predications of form, how could there be thoughts that fixate on the resplendent deity? When the fuel runs out, the blaze dies out. Therefore, even though meditation on the virtuous forms conceptual, as the conceptual predicates increase, its essence becomes by nature thought-free and confused mind without even specifically meditating on non-thought. When that happens, with mindfulness, not allowing yourself to forget the samadhi you've already experienced, is posting a lookout. Some manifestors say, with awareness, post a lookout, but this is incorrect. Meditation reaching the path of samadhi. And so this concludes the sections on shamatha. I'll speak about insight tomorrow. The final bit on shamatha reads, meditation reaching the pith of shamatha means the shamatha that accomplishes the six undefiled clairvoyances. The Nasada Vyas has said these days, saying that unaltered mind, Ishtanastra studying in shamatha, is the type of talk that makes all those who want the liberation of knowing the secret points of the true Dharma cry and shed tears when they hear it. No, actually, I should combine this with experience. This should be taught by combining it with one's own experience. Just reading the words and explaining the words, it's not all that beneficial. And there is some benefit, of course, but actually, if you really wanted to strike the point, you have to teach it from your experience. So for that reason, so since I don't have any experience, I mean, it's really difficult for me to actually combine it by teaching with combine my teaching with experience. In any case, when we're speaking about these methods of resting the mind, it's become meditation. If you're looking for meditation in some external object, you can't find it. If you're looking outside, you can't meditate. Meditation means you need to turn inward. And to look and take care of your mind. That's what we mean by meditation. With our mind, if we're looking outside, what is this, what is that, this is this object, this thing is that. So instead of having thoughts, thinking about like outside like that, is instead turning inside with your mind, looking at your mind. In your mind, you turn your mind inward and see, what is your mind? Let's look and see, well, what is your mind? And this is a really important point. So for this reason, no matter what instruction we're giving, we need to turn inside, we need to look inside ourselves. When we look at the stage that our mind is in, or the state that our mind is in, and what thoughts are moving in our mind, or what is the nature of our mind? What is the mind? It's important for us to think about this, in particular when we're meditating on the shamatha of Mahamudra, we need to turn our attention inward. We need to think, what is the nature of mind? What is the essence of mind? What is the mind? It's important for us to look at it. There's quite a bit that one could say about this, but the day we're talking, there are many people who are listening. Since there's so many people together, and if I said a lot of people, this is my experience, some people will like it, some people won't like it. And whether people like it or not, that's not the main thing, but even if people don't like it, if they don't like it, they won't feel faith, they won't develop faith. If they don't have faith, they won't receive develop devotion. If they don't develop devotion, they won't receive the blessings. And if you don't have devotion, then it's difficult to develop meditation yourself. So I don't need to say much today. In brief, when we're meditating on the shamatha of Mahamudra, the moment we become Dharma practitioners, we shouldn't look outside at other people. We shouldn't look outside. We shouldn't look at what other people are doing. What are people doing today? What are people talking about today? What's going on in the society? What are people in society doing? We shouldn't think only about that. Instead, we need to look inside at our own mind, turn our attention inwards to our own mind. Let's look at what our own situation is. But this is not talking about what is my physical situation, what's my health. We're talking about what is the situation with your mind. We can talk about like our health of the body. We can also talk like our health of the mind. What is the health of our mind? It's important to think about. It's really important for us to think about this. Because the reasons we all, you know, think about seeing other people's faults, we always see other people's things. This isn't okay. They're all making mistakes. We're seeing so many faults in other people. But if you say, are we free of faults? No, of course we have a lot of faults. We have a lot of faults. But the worst of the faults is that we don't see our own faults, and we only see other people's faults. Because of that, we can't improve ourselves. If you can't recognize what your faults are, you can't improve yourself. So if we're going to improve ourselves, in order to improve ourselves, we have to see our own faults. And in order to see our faults, we need to look at ourselves. We need to sort of look at ourselves. Is what I'm doing okay? Is the way I'm thinking okay? Is the way I act okay? Turn your attention inward and think more about what yourself is. This is what we, Dharma practitioners, do. We need to turn our attention inward and think more about what we're doing. We need to think about what do we think? Are they appropriate ways of thinking? What are the ways we act? Are there appropriate ways of acting? These are the things that we need to speak about most. We shouldn't be thinking about only about whether other people's act or whether other people think. That's not something that we should think about as Dharma practitioners. And this is a really important point. All of the great beings who have achieved siddhi have taken, looked at their own mind. They've all turned their intention inwards and looked inside. This is a really crucial point. This is the most important crucial point. And if you can't do that, no matter how many texts you might have read, if you're unable to fix your own or to heal your own mind, then there's like, we're the same as researchers at great universities abroad. They do a lot of research. And some of them, of course, do turn their attention inwards and think about this. I'm thinking about most of them, they don't. They're primarily looking, thinking about as a topic of study. And they have the aim of like getting a diploma. And they study it with this aim. This is their study, a research into Buddhism is in order to achieve Buddhahood and omniscience. It's not in order to develop their own mind. That's very difficult to say that. For ourselves, if we say we're Dharma practitioners, we say that we're the ones who are authentically practicing Buddhism. And if that's going to be the case, the most important point is that we look inside ourselves. If we don't, then our studying philosophy is basically a waste. I was saying they're spending a 3-year retreat and it's a wait, and whatever we're doing is just a waste. That's the main point. It's really important. It's very important that we understand this crucial point. Well, perhaps I should continue a little bit, otherwise I won't finish tomorrow. No, I won't read more. I'll talk about insight tomorrow. So maybe that's enough for today. So today was our first, the internet connection for our first day, so we'll leave it here for tonight. And so tomorrow I'll continue the teaching. So this year we've been continuing the Kajigansho with what we started here, doing the competitive debates, following the same way we did it last year. So last year, many of the monks who participated in the competitive race said that it was very good to continue in that way. And so we are continuing in the same that way. And I think that the competition has gone well. It's been very good in any case. As I said on the first day of the Gunsha, for us to improve our studies, to improve our study and teaching, there are several different methods. There's using debate as a method to improve wisdom. Another is to teach, write, and explain. And so these days, even in the great universities, people do research. If you do research as a way to improve your study and to improve your understanding, knowing, and to gain greater understanding of the texts. So people do research and they write papers. And so that's another method of doing meditation. And there's a very important point there. And the reason is that if we are using like our own intelligence to study many different texts, like the Buddhist and non-Buddhist, to the earlier and the later texts, then for ourselves, the result of research, we can develop a result from the realization from the research ourselves, and that's beneficial. Seems like I can look at many different scriptures, in the Kanjur and the Tanjur, and many older and later texts. This is not just talking about our own tradition. It's not talking about only the texts in our own tradition. Looking at all the texts and the treatises and the words of the Buddha, the early texts, the later texts, and studying them. This is one way to gain an understanding. This is talking about doing really detailed study. Really detailed research. It's not just sort of reading it isn't enough. Once you want to really study assiduously, you see, I can get to the point where I have this understanding. If you have that, you're able to get to the point where I have gained this understanding, then you've had a really special research. Special result. This is that we're not just following something, but as I mentioned the other day, we've talked about Lord Tsongkhapa at that time. He studied many sutras and panchas. He studied with many different great scholars, and he read many older Tibetan texts, many early Tibetan texts. And then at the end, he came to his own view and philosophy, and he was able to combine these all that have real particular features. And was able to write many different philosophical texts. And the reason why Lord Tsongkhapa was able to develop such a thing, so of course, for that to happen, some people say that it's because some people do, you know, raise objections saying that he doesn't match the thought of earlier masters and so forth. But if you think about it, he's just used his intelligence to do it. He spent a long time listening and contemplating. He researched greatly. And was able to produce a result himself. And this is the way it happens if you use your intelligence. If instead you're just following others, if you're just repeating what previous master said, if you're only repeating the previous master, that's difficult to make any progress. There's no improvement. In the future, during the Kaju Ganshu, I've been thinking about how we can accumulate more writing in the Ganshu. I haven't really thought it through completely, but in the future, I think. So we have not just a few Kempos who are writing papers, but also students. As many students as we can, within terms of their part of the studies, writing about the difficult points in the texts, or some of the more important topics in the texts. So when you talk about the importance of the important texts, but sometimes when you say the important points, then we sometimes forget about the lesser points. But actually, when you think that they're less important, but when you're actually researching that, they're really important points in there. And so we need to look at those as well. So when you talk about the main points or the difficult points of texts or some particular phrase, or even the smallest points of texts, if people can write papers on them, then we can this way develop their practice of writing, then I think this will definitely help us develop an understanding of the texts. And it would be a great benefit for us to really to go more deeply into the text. Because our debate, when we debate, It's something that would probably immediately just sort of speaking right over, having a talking about, there's a danger that we'll just be debating about the words. And it's simply the thing that we have to do something where people won't be able to be able to respond or find a fault and the other can't respond to. And when you're thinking in this way, sometimes it's difficult for it to go really, really deeply. If you're debating, well, of course, it's good, but sometimes our debates end up just being debates about words. And the debates is just, you know, it's just words. And if that, and in that way, it's kind of difficult for us to really get deeply into the points of the text. And so in this way, we need to use many different skillful means to improve our studies. And this is something I think a lot about. So I think that the teachers, the faculty all think about, and all of the monastics, I think if you have some opinions about this, then I think it would be good to speak about them freely during the conference. So we're talking about the if one person thinks it's better to have for many people to discuss, then it's better to have more people discussing than just one. So I think it's important for this to do. So I think that's basically it for today. So today is basically just creating a connection, an intermediate connection. So I haven't given a teaching for long, so now I've come to the end of the Gunsh teachings. And people are saying, what happened to the teaching? What happened to the teachings? People kept asking me, so there's no choice but to give. It wouldn't be right not to give it. It's a question of whether there's enough time to give a teaching and whether I have the time to do it. But it's like I'm giving this teaching in order to just make the connection. And so I think that is enough for today, and we will continue tomorrow.